Welcome to our simple studio here with a very simple teaching, but a very shocking teaching. Okay, and there's a tendency when we get shocked, we want a whole bunch of explanation. But the discipline that we're doing here is full stop in the wow, is when we get to feel this shock, like, wow, this is really shocking information. We don't start demanding more explanation. That's why I say full stop. Don't struggle with the struggle. Just say, okay, this information has stunned me because I wasn't quite aware of this yet. Now, I'm going through this whole process, same process also. This morning, I got so much clarity came that it was somewhat a little bit stunning. Truth does stun us because it's true. And we're not used to that. We're trying to make lies true. We're trying to make lies equally attractive to truth. And we're so focused on that when we see truth and we see how simply attractive it is, we say, wow, maybe I don't need to do anything with lies. And then we say, whoa, continuity problem. So the necessary discipline as you go forward is more and more practice full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. It's necessary discipline. Otherwise, you're going to generate too much mental activity and be searching for too many answers, trying to grab hold of straws everywhere. You just say, I'm not going to grab hold of any straws. Truth is good enough. It's good enough for me. But I have a continuity fear, so I'm just going to shake and tremble for a while like that. This is the way to do it. Otherwise, you'll end up stopping. You'll end up stalling out. And we don't want to stall out, especially at this time in the world where the cosmic corporate culture, actually, which is, what is the purpose? It thinks it has a mandate from God to get everybody working towards trying to make lies equally attractive to truth, try to make death equally attractive to life. And so it feels that if it doesn't do this, follow this so-called mandate from God, it will all be annihilated because we're not following the will of God. Keep in mind, we simply made up this imaginary change in the will of God. God's will for us is very simple. We're absolutely free. Absolutely free. That's it. That's it. But we made up, trying to be greater than God, we made up a change in God's will, which did not happen, has never happened, but we believe it has. That God's will for us is to make enslavement equally attractive to freedom, to make lies, death, enslavement, disempowerment equally attractive to freedom, our home, and to make a home of time, space, process, and form, a home of illusion, to make it feel equally attractive to our true home, okay, which is impossible, completely impossible. But this cosmic culture, cosmic corporate culture has incorporated this world and is demanding that we all focus on trying to make this world as attractive as possible. This is the false path. Okay, this is a false path. This is what we are hearing now in a clearer and clearer way. And when hearing it is shocking, it's shocking. It's like, because you realize, wow, this is true. But keep this in mind. Since we have believed that this is our function, that the will of God for us, our functionality, is to work to make the universe ultimately equally attractive to reality. To make time, space, process, form, nature, we call it, to make it equally attractive to reality. To make this delusion of disempowerment equally attractive to reality. Well, we're thinking, wow, I'm going to be working on this for a long, long time. And then we think, once we finish, then we'll just enjoy living in this world, you know, like, oh, it's such a paradise here now. We'll just enjoy living. And we believe that's our life. So we believe this is our life. This is our function. This is our life. And then when we find out there is no, God never gave us any such function at all. It's not our function. Then we say, well, what do? I don't know how to function then. See, because we projected forward in what we believe is time, that we'll be functioning this way forever, basically. I mean, it's going to take us a long, long time to be thinking. Many births. And this is in the back of our mind. This is what we feel. We expect our future, what we call the future, expect our functioning to continue on in this way indefinitely. And now we find out, wow, there is no such will of God to do this at all. We've just made all this up. And I don't have to function that way at all. Okay, so then we'd say, well, how am I going to function? This is called the continuity fear. This is what I'm saying is our central problem. And the answer is, what we do, instead of trying to make this world equally attractive to reality, trying to make nature equally attractive to reality, what we do is now we simply enjoy the attractiveness of reality, even while we're here in this realm, this imaginary dream realm. We enjoy the attractiveness of reality, the inherent attractiveness of reality. There's absolutely nothing we need to do to establish the attractiveness of reality. And there's absolutely nothing we need to do to sustain the attractiveness of reality. It's inherently attractive and inherently sustained, always, eternally, effortlessly on our part. No effort whatsoever. We simply enjoy this effortless attractiveness of absolute freedom, our true nature. We just begin to enjoy that. More and more and more we turn our attention to enjoying that. Maintenance free. It's all maintenance free. Now, just as this world, nature, is a symbol of disempowerment, it's a symbol of disempowerment that we're trying to make equally attractive to reality. We're trying to make it a co-reality. We're claiming there's a co-necessity to nature. And there isn't. This is something we have made up in our desire to try to change the will of God and prove we're greater than God. So, what we do, since we're used to this, what we do, since that this is a symbol of disempowerment, what we do is take an intermediate step so we can, and this is the symbol of empowerment. This nature is a symbol of disempowerment. Supernature is a symbol of empowerment. Supernature is a symbol of empowerment. And ultimately, once we get used to supernature and simply experiencing the attractiveness of reality, of freedom, once we get used to the attractiveness of our true nature so that we're comfortable and familiar with it, we say, oh, this is normal. This is home. This is normal. And I don't need to do anything for it to be so. This is the key point. We need to do nothing to create it and nothing to sustain it. It's inherently created this way and it's inherently sustained this way. Once we get used to this, then ultimately, we don't even need any more symbol for it. Don't even need any more symbol for it, but that's beyond the scope of what we need to focus on. We need to focus on the transition to supernature. We call it, some people call it different terms, different depending on what their traditions are. But there is a realm which is a symbol of empowerment, a symbol of freedom, a symbol of empowerment. And it's effortlessly sustained. There's absolutely no maintenance we need to do whatsoever there. Which is wonderful, having slaved my whole life trying to maintain this little tiny faint crumbs of attractiveness that we seem to believe are in this world. That is absolutely wonderful. No maintenance and no slaves doing the maintenance. It's inherently sustained by the will of God, actually, by the grace of God, by the grace of God. Supernature is sustained by the grace of God, effortlessly. Nothing we need to do to maintain it. We don't need to cut the grass. We don't need to water the grass. We don't need to water the plants. We don't need to do anything to sustain it. And obviously, there's no way we can ever have such a situation in this world, in this realm, right? Totally impossible. Anyone who keep in and just think about that. Those who claim, oh no, we can make a paradise for earth. Really? Who's going to do all the maintenance and all the sustaining? Well, we'll have robots doing them. Who's going to sustain and maintain all the robots? And who's going to, you know, deploy them? Now, in supernature, there's no robots. There's nothing being deployed. There's no strategy. There's no bureaucracy trying to manage all the robots or all the humans. Okay, there's no cosmic corporate culture saying, here's the massive bureaucratic regulatory structure that you must follow in order to try and make this world seem attractive where everything in their lives is regulated. You know, there's none of that whatsoever. None of it. No. We just take a little break here because this again, even though we've heard this before maybe, or maybe for the first time, it's shocking. It's absolutely shocking. Because we think, well, how am I going to function again? You say, wait, I thought I was going to have, you know, millions of rebirths and be working on this universe forever, and now I realize I don't even have to work on another day, not even another instant. So, wow. So the continuity problem is at the root of it, and this is why we practice full stop in the now. Just like, wow, this, realizing that no matter how clever our conceptual structure is, the truth shocks us because our functionality realizes I don't have to function the way I've been functioning. I don't have to try and create, sustain, and maintain great attractiveness of nature at all, attractiveness of the universe at all. Attractiveness of time, space, process, and form. I don't have to lift a finger at all. And of course, ultimately, that means you don't need a body at all, right? What are bodies but robots, actually, that we've designed to try to make nature attractive? Biological robots. See, he's starting to ring some bells here. Bells of remembrance. Now, in SuperNature, we might still seem to have a body or form, but there's nothing it needs to do. We just sit quietly. Or just walk quietly, sit quietly. But the body doesn't need to cut anything, doesn't need to construct anything, doesn't need to maintain anything, doesn't need to organize, doesn't need to structure. No, doesn't need, no need for that. So, but what's happening is spirit is appreciating the symbol of empowerment, the symbol of freedom, the symbol of empowerment. Like, wow, this really reminds me of my home. And spirit is just like enjoying the reminder of home, the reminder of reality, the reminder of the will of God. Effortlessly. Enjoying the effortlessness of it is a way to put it. Enjoying the effortless. How can we enjoy the effortlessness of it here? Now, of course, there are those who try to get real rich and powerful so they can pay other people to make their lives seem effortless. But it's not. They have to keep working to get the money. They have to fight off those who are trying to steal their money. They have to manage all the headaches and the regulations and the lawsuits. It's not effortless for them. It's terrible. It's really terrible. Awful. You know, the drug lords get a bunch of money and they think they have these mansions, but they're terrified of the police catching them and they have to pay off everybody, you know. And it's hell. It's hell. This is hell. This is hell. Hell is hell, you know. So don't try to make hell heaven. That is a big mistake. That's why Jesus said, don't try to make illusions real and then get rid of them. This is the mistake we're making. So just take a little time, just full stop in the now, full stop in like, your mind doesn't have to be thinking, does it? Because what is all this thinking? We're thinking, how can we make the universe more attractive? Thinking that this is our functioning, it's not. We gave this functioning to ourselves as if it was the will of God, and it is not our function to determine, to author the will of God. That is not our functioning. We cannot be the author of the will of God. We cannot be the author of ourselves. We cannot be the creators of ourselves. That's what we're playing out, this fantasy, actually, that we're our own creators, and so we decided what the will of God is for us. And of course, we think our functioning is to continue to support this nonsense, and it's not. And then again, setting down our functioning is continuity fear. Continuity fear. So the question of the mind, well, how do I, it goes right back into, well, how do I take this information and make the world more attractive with it? That's why I say full stop, don't move. Sitting, don't get up from where you're sitting. Because obviously if you don't get up from where you're sitting, you're not able to do anything to the world. You're not able to make anything here. You're not able to maintain anything here. You're just sitting. It's very important. And this is the burn. As you're sitting, there's a burn. Like, say, wow, I just got this great information now. How do I translate that into action in the world to make the world more attractive? You don't. You don't. You don't. And so you'll feel this burn, like, wow. And this is where you need to just keep sitting. This is why it's part of the discipline. It's a necessary discipline. If you're going to succeed, it's a necessary discipline. Very difficult. You say, well, I could cure the world of cancer. I could make it, you know, I could do this. No, this is not the path. This is not the way. This is not what others need to hear. This is not what others need to see. So as you feel like you need to leap into your familiar functioning, trying to make the world equally attractive, trying to make the world equally attractive to reality, and then you don't do that. You just sit still. You don't do it. You're going to feel agitation, and you may be shaking or trembling, or it's like, my gosh, I need to act. I need to act. I need to act. And you're not acting. This is the burn. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the burn. This is what it is. Sometimes, you know, after practicing, I feel like I need to go out and plant like a million flowers. I need to make, you know, my gosh, I need to use my energy here to you know, make the world more beautiful. And I need to, oh yeah, and then just no. Oh, I need to spread images of nature everywhere. I need to get beautiful music. I need to. No, there's no co-necessity. There is no such thing as co-necessity. The only necessity we have is absolute freedom. There is no co-necessity whatsoever. And if we're frantically out there trying to improve the attractiveness of the world, we will not allow this to settle in. So this is why sitting quietly and not getting up is very important. Don't get up from your seat. Well, I need to get up and get a cup of tea, or I need to... No, don't do it. Commit to sitting quietly for a chunk of time. This is the discipline. And in doing this, you will find the burn is less and less and less eventually, less and less and less. It's still there to an extent, yeah, absolutely. Keep in mind that the desire to make something that is unattractive attractive requires that you have the unattractive, and reality cannot be unattractive. So what must this unattractiveness be that we're working to make attractive? It must be a dream. It must be a mirage, an illusion, a hallucination. So trying to make hallucinations of ugliness more attractive is forgetting the fact that we're hallucinating, you see. What we need to do is we need to give up hallucinating. And the way to do that is to have a final hallucination, which is a hallucination of empowerment, of effortless empowerment. A symbol. Hallucinations are symbols, actually. All hallucinations are symbolic. Where we don't need to do any effort whatsoever, and ultimately realize we don't even need to hallucinate at all. But certainly, if we're hallucinating, if we have a desire to be greater in God, we're going to hallucinate unattractiveness and then make it attractive. So the unattractiveness, it seems to be screaming at us to, you know, all the hideous stuff in the world, the sickness. Don't do anything about it, really. Not in terms of trying to actually change it. Certainly charity is perfectly fine. The basics here. But not an attempt to change the world at all. Not an attempt to try to make it a better place. No, this is a great mistake. This is why, now, I say, cosmic corporate culture, which I say, this is a universal delusion. And this world, this planet here, has been targeted to be incorporated into cosmic corporate culture, which means total dedication to trying to make this nature equally attractive to reality. So we can say we don't even need reality. This is equally attractive. We'll stay here. This world has been targeted and has been incorporated. This is why we're feeling the stress and the pressure and the strain right now. Like we feel like deep down we feel, wow. I feel like there's an attempt to try and distract me away from truth. And we're worried about it. And we should be. Be distracting our attention away from what leads us back to truth is something we should be concerned about. Absolutely. Let's not go too quick here. Sometimes we have to realize, let's just take a breather. We're doing wind sprints here, wind sprints. Best way to get in shape, wind sprints. But it's difficult. People complain, of course. If people aren't complaining, then I'm probably not doing my job. I'm saying, come on, another wind sprint. Oh, no, let's talk about wind sprints. No, let's do the wind sprint. Let's not talk about it, let's do it. This incorporation of planet Earth here is going to be, will be completed by July of 2016. And then everyone will be expected to go along with this now, the new regime, expected. With consequences if you don't. Consequences that we sort of have a feeling for, like, uh-oh. So we still feel a little bit free here, to disagree and focus on truth. But because the consequences have not yet been brought to bear entirely, but they're very close to being put in place now, very close. There are many, many consequences actually that are in place already, but there will be basically the will of the planet will decide it's okay to put severe consequences in place for those who do not go along with with this agenda now, who do not act according to what's expected of them. It's like a corporation taking over a smaller corporation, gobbling them up, and then coming in and saying, okay, folks, this is how we're going to do it now. Here's your new CEO. We'll answer to our CEO. This is the new financial structure. This is what you're expected to do. This is how you're expected to work. They basically put a new set of management expectations into the business that they incorporated. It's exactly the same way as happened to planet Earth. It's been incorporated, swallowed up by a bigger corporation. And the bigger corporation has now put its management team in place of this planet. And this management team is now telling us how we need to restructure our expectations and our functioning here to comply with the new corporate rules. This is exactly what's happened here. And, you know, full compliance is by July of 2016, I believe, will be required to have full compliance, just like the healthcare laws are saying you must have insurance, you must now be in compliance with these new laws. Okay, well, this will be a much bigger thing. And the crackdown will be very severe. If you think about severity of crackdown, just think about China. Okay, think about China and how it cracks down on any dissidents of what it expects you to do. You see, this is a model. China's like a model of this cosmic corporate culture. They got their fingers into China and said, okay, and they, of course, they told the Chinese, you know, you deserve to be the leaders and rulers, the management team of this world. You've been here, they'll have the oldest culture in the world, basically. And the Chinese have always felt that they have a divine right to rule this world. Of course, the Japanese also think that, and many people think that. But the Chinese very much believe this. And so they're very much receptive to the cosmic corporate culture. And they help the cosmic corporate culture get its grips on this world, as has the United States. They believe that they have a manifest destiny to rule the world too, as does the Vatican. But that's a slightly different story, actually. What has happened with this new Pope, Pope Francis, is that the Vatican is now in alignment with the Chinese, which is really in alignment with the United States. And this is the new world order. Chinese, the Vatican, the United States are all basically on the same page, and they're serving cosmic corporate culture. That's why Pope Benedict resigned. That was the end of the papacy, actually, when Pope Benedict resigned. Because he actually was holding the line of cosmic spiritual culture and saying, no, these are some standards you have to keep believing in Jesus. Jesus has eternal life for us. The world is not it, you know. And so he was holding that line, and finally it was too much. He realized the game is up. It's finished. And now we have this massive change in the Vatican, actually, which is going towards narrowing the focus down to just charity, you know, that's it. And in other words, going along with cosmic corporate culture. So like I said, with the line with the Chinese, the United States, and the Vatican, it's curtains for us. Absolutely it is. And that's why you've seen this massive change in the Vatican, of Pope Francis basically saying, guess what? Cosmic corporate culture is where it's at, folks. Isn't this great? Now we can all get along and be on the same page here in this world. Fantastic. Everyone, and the progressives are those who are in compliance, or at least totally eager to be in compliance with cosmic corporate culture, be in compliance with their expectations. Those are the progressives. The conservatives are saying, no. I don't think that's the way, right? They got at least some feeling of maybe cosmic spiritual culture is the way. They're saying, whoa. So the progressives are just like cheering Pope Francis. It's like, this is the greatest thing ever. They say, finally got our Pope. They finally got our Pope, the black Pope. They just love it because he's saying, yeah, everything you guys believe, we believe too. Cosmic corporate culture is wonderful. It's the will of God. This planet's going to be a very attractive place. We just got to solve all these problems here and make it really attractive. So of course, with all of these forces in the world now aligned, compliance will be mandatory by July 2016, very soon. It's coming very soon. Because there's no more resistance to it, you see, in the high places. So we have a new management team in charge of this planet Earth, new management team. And most of the people in the world are frantically trying to get in compliance with it. Frantically trying to get in compliance with it. Because they realize that if they don't, you know, they're going to, they potentially could suffer the wrath of, you know, just look at the Chinese deal with those who are not in compliance with their management mandates. Tibet, Falun Gong, various Christians in their country, and various, you know, wow, you see, they don't fool around, do they? This is what's coming. This is what's coming for the world. This is what is coming for the world. Now, Pope Benedict met with the Dalai Lama. Pope Francis said, no, China doesn't like it. Right. Now, what about the fact, how do we get in compliance? What if we're not in compliance? This is a question, isn't it? But we just need to look at this as, okay, this is a concern. This is a question, it's a concern. Just make it, clarify it clear. Okay, well, what is the concern? Well, what if we're not in compliance with the new management team of planet Earth? What if we're not in compliance, the new cosmic corporate culture? Now, I've spoke with many who are not in compliance, but what their plan is to resist it, you know, through force. And I say, whoa, okay, all right, let's see if we can find a better option than that, because that's not going to go too well. You understand, well, it's the United Nations, it's the United States, under this president that turned it to the alliance, to the United Nations, to the Vatican, to the Chinese. The only country that's really resisting is Russia, actually. That's where they're trying to sabotage Russia's economy through lowering the price of oil. This is a collusion between the New World Order to lower the price of the barrels of oil, about cut in half, which is basically trying to bankrupt Russia, because Russia is not going along, you see. Russia is not going along with this. Reason. So there's this global attack upon Russia taking place right now, actually. Trying to isolate Russia, completely collapse their economy. But this is a dangerous game to be playing. You know, be careful of the bear, you know, the Russian bear. Don't push him too far, as I have said. But I don't know exactly what is going to happen. But anyway, if we're not in compliance, what? That's the question. What if we're not in compliance? What if we're not in compliance? And a lot of people are saying, well, we'll just, you know, keep fighting until we run out of ammo, that kind of thing. Well, you can't buy ammo anymore. Hey, you know, hello. Yeah, remember, he who has the most ammo wins the war. Those who run out of ammo, they lose. So that's not probably the best plan, you know. Resistance is not necessarily the best plan. So our focus, at least we have a question. But what if we don't want to be in compliance with this? So I'm introducing SuperNature, supernatural realm, cosmic spiritual culture. What options do they have for us? You see, what options do they have for us? And again, I received an invitation to visit Jesus' dwelling place. And I said, well, great, where is it? He said, it's right adjacent to here, very close, just adjacent to where we are. I said, wow, I was blown away by that. I thought it was like distant. And so let's look at this issue. Let's look at this issue. I said, this morning I was looking at this. And I realized we just assume that perfection, a perfect realm, okay, death-free, supernatural realm, a symbol of empowerment, must be very far from here. Very, very, very far from here. I just assumed that. Why? Well, we assume that anything that's like really ugly and terrible, that something that beautiful and wonderful can't be close to it because it'll be contaminated by it, right? So we automatically assume that there must be a great distance between what is super offensive and horrible and what is, you know, stainless and immaculate and pure, right? It cannot be just adjacent. We think that we cannot be adjacent. And yet Jesus told me it's adjacent. I said, where's your dwelling place? He said, it's adjacent to this, to where we are. It's right over the fence. I mean, here we are, and there's a fence, and then adjacent, but on the other side of this fence is my dwelling place, SuperNature. I said, wow, it's not far away. And this is just like, wow. I assumed it was like far away. And I realized that we're all assuming this, that it must be far away. And it's not, it's just adjacent, totally adjacent to where we think we find ourselves, where we believe we find this world here, nature, is adjacent. And this really stretches our mind, it really stretches it. And this is part of the fear we have. We think, yeah, great, SuperNature, but it's going to take a long journey. Maybe we'll be journeying for millions of years to get there. This is what cosmic corporate culture tells us. It's just, SuperNature, well, yeah, they don't want to totally deny it, because then, you know, you'll think, hey, wait a minute, you know, they're lying. So they say, oh, yeah, you could go there, but, you know, it's going to be like millions and millions of years of journey before you get there. It's really far away from here. And you just, then it crushes you, you know, crushes you. I've experienced that. It's very interesting. That's another story. Very interesting. Again, there are not co-necessities. And believing that they're co-necessities, we think there's God and a goddess, right? Necessity, God's will and the goddess's will. The goddess, of course, what we believe is the will to make nature equally attractive to reality. And the goddess is the one that inspires us to do this. Okay. This is all delusion. This is all a fantasy. There is no co-necessity. There is no co-reality. There is no co-will. There is no co-redeemer. There is no co-anything. Okay? This is a fantasy that we have. Anyway, this goddess that told me this imaginary co-redeemer, co-will of God, co-necessity, co-reality, supposed ruler of co-reality, said, oh yeah, there is SuperNature, and I'll take you there, but it's like millions and millions and millions of years across space. You'll be traveling for almost forever to get there. And then I said, like, oh, wow, you know, I don't think I can, I don't want that. She said, oh, well, that's too bad. Maybe you can't go then. See, and that actually sent me into a spiral of troubles. Of course, total lie. And so that's when Jesus told me, no, my place is just adjacent to here. This is why I was so surprised. So again, our self-deception, cosmic corporate culture, which is just projection of our self-deception, will tell us, will say, oh yeah, SuperNature, SuperRealm, yeah, that is an option, you're right, I forgot about that, you're right. And sure, we'll help you go there, but you do realize it's, you know, millions and millions of light years from here. It's all the way across the whole universe, actually, is where it is. Very distant, but sure, we'll travel there. We'll put you on a spaceship, and you can start traveling there. You'll get there in, you know, a couple of 100 million years. They say, whoa. And they say, or you could stay here and work on making this world more attractive. Plant some flowers for us. You say, oh yeah, okay, I better do that. So just this morning, I realized how potent that is, and how I got deceived and trapped by that. So that's very important to point out here. And I'm sure it's quite shocking, is that SuperNature, the death-free realm, is just adjacent to this world. It's not even a hop, skip, and a jump. It'd be there like that. That's how close it is. And this is indeed stunning, because then they realize, oh, there's no problem in going to SuperNature then. No problem at all. And then they said, whoa, because we thought, yeah, supernature, that's great. I like to hear that. Yeah, eventually we'll get there, maybe, yeah. But millions and millions of light years away, well, I can't do that now. And yet still serve the attempt to make this, you know, realm, the realm of disempowerment, symbolic disempowerment, make that more equally attractive to reality. We'll do both. We'll believe in both, but our functioning will be to make us attractive. But now when so this is what our expectations are, you know, this compromise. You know, we can still believe in it, but we just can't get there. It's too far away. Oh, it's too bad. But now we realize, no, it's completely adjacent, just adjacent. There's no distance whatsoever for us to travel there. So this brings the whole situation into a different, totally different focus, doesn't it? And this is where the wow, the shock of wow is. Now that I'm realizing that this is why we're afraid of Jesus, we're afraid of meeting anyone of cosmic spiritual culture, because we think that they're here to take us to supernature, which is just, we believe, is a vastly long trip. And so we stay away, stay away, stay away, stay away. No, I don't want to go on that long trip. That's too long of a trip for me. And now I realize there's no trip at all. I mean, it's just adjacent. So I'm not so scared anymore. Very interesting. This is why when Jesus invited me several months ago to visit his dwelling place, and I said, well, nothing's happened since then, you know. Well, it has to give me time to process this that is adjacent and to realize this is the crucial realization that we need to have. And that just happened this morning. Thanks be to God. This is a really big wow. It's a shock. So all this work I've been doing and urging others to do it is certainly designed in part to get to the point where we can accept the wow that supernature is adjacent, totally adjacent. There's no long trip at all to get there. None whatsoever. It's a piece of cake. It totally changes the whole equation. See, we keep saying, well, where's Jesus? You know, where are these emissaries of cosmic spiritual culture that are supposed to help us out? Where are they? I can't find them anywhere. They must be bogus. They don't exist. Well, because they're so attractive, and what they attract us to is so wonderful that we want to go there, but we feel it'll be a vast, vast journey, which just scares the heck out of us. You say, well, I'm maybe 20 more years to live. I can't spend a hundred million year journey. And so we say, stay away, stay away, stay away, stay away, stay away. The reason why we don't encounter and get more direct help is because we say, stay away, stay away, stay away. That's why. That is why it scares us. But once we realize it's totally adjacent to where we believe we are, then where's the fear, you see? There's no journey at all. Needed. No journey at all needed. So, you talk about wow, this is a mega wow. But you don't get to the mega wow until you work through, you know, the lesser wows, which is why I'm saying full stop in the wow. This is wowism, full stop in the wow. And you have to be able to get here without conceptualizing it, without getting into your mind and thinking, without getting into your thinking, which means it cannot be too fearful for you. That's why you have to gradually evaporate the fear. But so what am I feeling now? Like alarm, you know, like wow. This is suddenly a 100 million mile journey just suddenly became completely unnecessary. Poof, vanished. So my expectations of the future, poof, vanished. My function, my expected functioning, poof, vanished. The troubles, poof, vanished. You know, the distance, poof, vanished. Right? If you like driving somewhere and you say, I got a long way to go, and suddenly you realize, wait a minute, I'm pulling into the parking lot, I'm already here. It's like, whoa, what happened to the, I was expecting a long journey. I had my lunch with me. I had planned where I was going to stop along the way. And I was listening to CD and singing along. What happened on the journey? It's over. You know, it's like, whoa, I'm already here. So it's like that. It's like, whoa, I'm already here. Same thing with Jesus. Like, we meet with Jesus. We're like, whoa, Jesus is already here. I was thinking it was going to take, like, much longer. So I had my life planned out, you know, and accordingly. And so when you say, it's already here. Well, what happened to all the life I had planned out? What happened to all my plans? That's why Jesus tells us, don't make any plans. Don't even make a plan for the next second. And this is how I've tried to live my life, actually. I don't make any plans. I try not to make any plans. As little as possible, I do not structure the future. As little as possible. That's why people ask, what are you going to do? I have no idea what I'm going to do. Just whatever. You know, whatever comes up, we'll just go with that. I don't have any plans. Because the more you plan the future, the more severe your continuity fear gets. Okay? And cosmic corporate culture is all about planning your future. Planning the future, which is why it generates a massive continuity fear. You want to avoid it like the plague. So I'm experiencing a massive wow right now, that is for sure. But, you know, not troublesome, not so bad. I mean, Since being used to this, I've already burned away so much of the continuity fear that it's not too bad. But it's still, I can feel that obviously it's very profound. And so what's saying, I don't know what to think, meaning I don't know what my plans are now. See? So don't try to, since your plans for the future have simply evaporated, don't try to then frantically throw up a bunch of plans for the future. This is what I mean by full stop in the wow. Don't try to reconstruct all the plans that you had that just went poof. Just rest in, well, I don't need any plans, do I? See, in SuperNature, you don't need any plans. You just enjoy the attractiveness of home. Enjoy the attractiveness of home. That's it. So when your plans go poof, don't struggle with the struggle, because you're feeling like, whoa, I'm kind of disoriented. I've already arrived. Or I'm almost ready to arrive. Oh my gosh, what happened to the journey? All the plans I had for the journey. There's a struggle there. And just enjoy that. Don't try to reconstitute the journey. Don't try to reconstitute your plans. Just get used to the plans having vanished. Just say, this is really cool. I like this. Don't project too far ahead about plans. Just for a while, enjoy feeling like, I don't know what my plans are. This is what full stop in the wow means. I don't know what my plans are, and that's okay. I have faith that everything is going to be better than I can imagine, with even without me planning right now. Which is why I say, don't take action when you have this wow. Full stop in the wow means keep sitting quietly. Because you don't know what your plans are right now, so how can you take action? It's different. See, as soon as you try to take action, then you start thinking about plans of action. This is not to say that we will be entirely without any plan at all. That would be functioning in reality, which we're not quite ready yet for because of our still continuity fear. But we do need to get more and more used to less and less plants. Again, in SuperNature, there's no need for any maintenance. We didn't create it. We don't need to sustain it. We don't need to maintain it. There's no maintenance. So we don't need to make plans of how do I maintain this? How do I make it? We don't need to make it better. See, here, we're constantly trying to make the world more attractive. So we're always thinking, we're planning the future. Future is our plans. How do we make this world more attractive? Whereas in SuperNature, you don't need to make it more attractive at all. It's perfect already. And we don't need to do anything to maintain the attractiveness. In this world, we're thinking, well, we seem to make this world a little more attractive, but how do we maintain that? It's very difficult. Everything's decaying here. So how do we maintain it? So we plan our future, all these plans. In SuperNature, we don't need any such plans. So you need to get used to feeling like, hey, I don't need plans in order to function properly. I don't need to be a planner in order to be fulfilling my function. My function in SuperNature is just to enjoy. Just to abide in this wonderful enjoyment. Like, wow, this is wonderful. This is great. I just love this. Just appreciate and enjoy. That's it. And wherever we go in SuperNature, it's all equally reminding us of our home. So we don't need to have plans about warm trips. Like, okay, I need to take this trip and I have to go here and make all these plans for, well, I need to, you know, take a vacation to go someplace that's more attractive. So I need to plan the vacation and the money, the travel, you know, the shots, the everything. Don't need to make any plans like that at all. Wherever I go, I'm equally reminded of the attractiveness of home. So I can either sit quietly there, or I can wander. So getting used to functioning without planning is crucial. This is why I say full stop in the wow. And the wow is when you make a breakthrough, a glimpse of, wow, I don't need a future of plans. I don't need all these plans that we call the future. Poof. Wow. So that's why I say this is wowism. It is truly wowism. No planism. And of course we say, well, how can we function in this world? Well, we're preparing to function in SuperNature. The supernatural realm, the death-free realm. This is the preparation, as Sri Anandamayi said. All of you, whether you like it or not, all of you without exception, will eventually have to dwell. You will dwell in the death-free realm. There's no escaping this. You must dwell in the death-free realm, is what she said. And so you have to prepare for that, because plans are not needed there. And again, cosmic corporate culture is all about planning the future. This is what it's about. So the Chinese, the Vatican, the United States, the United Nations are all on the same page now saying, we are going to blueprint and plan the future down to the last detail. This is what cosmic corporate culture does. It's all about planning the future of how can we maximize our energy and efforts and thinking and thoughts to making nature equally attractive to reality, equally attractive to pure freedom. How can we make the delusion of determinacy equally attractive to the absolute spontaneous indeterminacy of reality? And so they're all about detailed blueprinting of the future. So you will be caught up. You're expected to go along with this. So you'll be caught up in that. And this, of course, creates this massive continuity fear for you of SuperNature. You become very frightened of it because you say, I need plans. You think that plans are your identity. You believe that planning the future is your functioning, your identity. It's not. It's a false, fake identity which we're trying to make seem as attractive as our true identity, and which is futile. So that is why I keep urging, saying, look, this incorporation of this planet by cosmic corporate culture, you don't want to get caught up in that. So, as much as possible, practice this wow, full stop on the wow, of my plans just evaporating. I don't need the future. I don't need all these plans. The citizens of SuperNature do not need any such plans, so we're practicing to be citizens of SuperNature. Once you're a citizen of SuperNature, you don't need to return to this world at all. You don't need, because you realize you don't need any such plans. You don't need any such functioning. And you're free of the cycles of birth and death and rebirth. Free of it, absolutely free. So we're practicing to be citizens of SuperNature. This is the goal. Now the end times that Jesus talked about are simply when cosmic corporate culture incorporates this planet and then demands that everybody be in compliance with being exclusively focused on planning the future, planning the future, planning the future, and working on trying to make the delusion of determinacy equally attractive to pure freedom. This is the end times, this is the apocalypse, this is the, you know, tribulation time, all of this stuff. This is what is being referred to. This is where we're at now. And of course Jesus tells, don't worry, I've gone to prepare a dwelling place, quote unquote, prepare a dwelling place for you. And I will come back and take you to the dwelling place. So where I am, you will be also, and you will dwell with me there. He's talking about SuperNature, which is totally adjacent to this realm, completely adjacent, no journey necessary. No journey necessary. And no plans are necessary there, except just, you just inherently enjoy. That's your functioning, just enjoy. Now we think, well, that's impossible, I need to plan. No, it's not. I mean, I've practiced that a lot in this world, as much as I can, trying to find something where you just, I used to go like the Rose Gardens and just practice with a video camera, actually, and you make it, they look even more beautiful than they seem, and just walk in the Rose Garden and just enjoy. There were no thoughts of planning or anything about the day, life, what, nothing. Just enjoy the beauty. That's basically what I've tried to do with my life. It's no plans, just enjoy the beauty. Now, it's impossible for us to create anything or even imagine anything that is without some tinges of beauty, because our very nature is sheer attractiveness. So even in this world, which is an attempt to get rid of all attractiveness of reality and to make a different reality, a co-reality, which is unattractive, and then make that unattractive co-reality attractive to us by believing we can change what we are so we're attracted to unattractiveness. Even in doing that, we cannot get rid of some tinges of beauty here in this world. And we see beautiful flowering rose gardens, and we just say, oh. So we sort of have a wistful, faint reminder of, you know, I sort of caught a faint fragrance of something that reminded me of long ago, far, far away, of, I'm not sure what it is, you know, but it's that faint tinge of attractiveness to the reality we might feel. So, but it is possible. People try to practice that here, taking walks on the beach, just trying to just feel like this effortless attractiveness, that all I'm doing is just feeling this everywhere. I feel this just effortless attractiveness, just of everywhere. That's maintenance free. Some people like to sit by the ocean, just feel just the beauty of the ocean, just this effortless attractiveness, you know. Don't have to do anything to maintain or sustain it like that. They're trying to practicing to be citizens of supernature. Absolutely. So many of us have actually been practicing for this, actually. We may not be so conscious of it. It doesn't quite rise to conscious, full consciousness here. We feel like, you know, we just want to drop out of society, culture, planning for the future, drop out and just enjoy and just effortlessly enjoy. But we find it's not so easy in the world the way it is now, with all the cosmic corporate culture now is in charge of this world, with all the satellites and all the technology they're using. They are identifying every square centimeter of this planet and who's there and where you are. And you will be required to get with their agenda. You will be required to. It's all about planning the future. Instead of just letting everything just flow. Reality is just a flow. There's no planning of the future to it. It's a flow of your enjoyment. So instead of that, they're going to insist that you get on board with meticulously planning the future. And if you don't want to do so much, then you'll just be a lowly slave carrying out their blueprint, their planning, central planning. Okay, it's all about central planning. Ring a bell? Central planning? China? New World Order? United Nations? Central planning? Hello? This is what's going on. It has been for quite some time. The purpose, really, of this world of religion is to prepare you to be a citizen of supernature. That's its purpose here. That's its purpose. Prepare you to be a citizen of supernature. Once you're a citizen of supernature, you need not return to the realms of conditioned existence at all. You need not return at all. No need to return whatsoever. You're free of that. You're free of that delusion. You've repented. You've awoken from that nonsense. You've recognized it. It is nonsense. You have no need for it. There's no need at all. There's no need for co-needs. Co-need. Co-necessity. There is no co-necessity. We just imagine this, like invented it. It was an imaginary invention. There's no co-necessity whatsoever. There's no co-reality whatsoever. No need for a co-reality. No need for a co-necessity whatsoever. And the acceptance of this is what enables you to be a citizen of supernature. And of course, being a citizen of supernature, ultimately, you're then able to be a citizen of reality. You're able to drop even that symbolic, you know, the symbol of empowerment. Don't even need that anymore, eventually. And Jesus says it doesn't take long. It doesn't take long, actually, at all. It doesn't take long. But it can take as long as we want. Need to be in a hurry about it. But once we're a citizen of supernature, we are free of death, for sure. Free of birth and bodies, death, all of the cycles of nature. We're free of it. No, we realize have absolutely no need for it. None. How we get free? We realize we have no need for it. Because supernature solves the continuity problem for us perfectly. Need nothing more than that. That's it. And again, I say, whoa, I have all these plans for helping out the universe, and whoops, poof, gone. You don't need to help the universe. You need to help those who believe in the universe. That's what you need to help. You need to invite those who are still believing in there's a universe, I need to make it attractive, make a co-reality. Invite them to SuperNature. You know, you don't need that. You can be a citizen of SuperNature. That's the invitation I got. I said, yeah, how can I be a citizen of SuperNature? Well, you need to evaporate your continuity fear. Okay, let me get to work on it. Keep in mind that we've told ourselves, with falsely motivated ourselves with a lie, that if we don't make the unattractive equally attractive to reality, if we don't make lies equally attractive to us as truth, that God will annihilate us. This is the lie we've told ourselves to motivate ourselves. So when we get ready to, you know, be a citizen of SuperNature, and you know, we get this hard sell, like saying, how dare you do this? You can't do this. Eventually you'll be annihilated. God will catch up with you and say, you didn't function the way I created you to function. So therefore, you must be annihilated, you know. We get this hard sell, you know, this stuff. And we get to say, oh, look. We'll acknowledge your spiritual, your great spiritual guru. We'll acknowledge this, as long as you then use that to motivate everyone else here in the world to improve the attractiveness of nature. And we'll worship you. We'll make an idol of you. We'll say you're the top guru in the world, the greatest guru there's ever been. As a matter of fact, we'll actually claim you're the greatest guru there's ever been or ever will be, the top of the top or most. We'll worship you as God, as long as you use your attractiveness. As long as you use that, you know, the attractiveness that you're feeling, as long as you use that, it's to motivate everyone in the world to work on making this world attractive. See, this is the deal that they try to make with you. The goddess tries to sell you on this, actually. And if you think that it's a long journey to SuperNature, you're going to succumb to that, you see. Or at least you'll feel conflicted, like, I know it's wrong, but I can't quite resist. But when you realize that SuperNature is just totally adjacent to where we are, no journey at all, you know, sorry goddess, thanks but no thanks. Listen, it's better to be a citizen of SuperNature than to be the greatest idol in history, okay? Way better. As Jesus says, the lowest in SuperNature is higher than the highest in this universe. And of course, there is no real lowest in SuperNature, exactly, you know, really. But this is just a, you know, figure of speech we're using. So, don't take that deal. Don't take that deal. The goddess has got many thinking about that deal, I know, as she got me thinking about that deal, too. And I said, I think there's something wrong with that. I don't like that. And the hook was, oh yeah, SuperNature exists. I'll get you there eventually, but it's hundred million light years from here. But, you know, in the meantime, let's help out make this universe seem more attractive. This is so if you hear this, you may realize, oh my gosh, I'm not really enslaved by the goddess. I can say no to her. I can say no to the goddess, absolutely. It is a huge wow. I can say no to the goddess. And her, she'll say, look, everyone is so attracted to me. I'm the whole idea of attractiveness of nature. So I will tell them that you are God, and they'll worship you, you see, as God, if you just make this deal with me. Yeah. And you say, wow. She says, yeah, everyone will serve you. And say, you're the greatest. You're the greatest guru, the highest guru that there's ever been or ever will be. And no one will ever even get equal to you, ever. You will be the greatest. And I will tell everybody that this is true. And they must worship you thusly. And, you know, you're like, wow. Yeah. Wow, no thanks. But again, the hook is the belief of the distance of supernature. Somehow that it would take us an impossibly, intolerably long time to get there. And in my meeting with Jesus, he pointed out where it is. I said, where is your dwelling place? Right there. He said, wow. It's so close. I said, that's what I said, it's so close. I thought it was far away. I asked him, how do I get there? He says, right here. I said, holy cow, that's easy to get there. That's no problem at all. Wow, and that was a big, big wow. The ramifications are enormous. That's why I came in a dream. It's easier to sustain functioning in this world if the realization is just below the threshold of this functional consciousness in this world. But bringing it through to full consciousness in this world is difficult because the ramifications are so strong. That's what's happening right now. It's taking me several months to do this. What you do in the full stop layout, don't chase down the ramifications, don't follow them. You know they're there, just realize they'll be there. But right now, I'm in the shock of like, my plans just evaporated. All possibility of ever being the greatest guru that's ever been, poof, gone. The goddess is poof, gone. The old goddess is only there to try and seduce you into this deal. And once you say no deal, poof, goddess gone too. The dualistic God goddess, poof, gone. It's like, wow. So don't chase down the ramifications, there are too many. Leave that for a later date. Just enjoy the poof, gone. No plans, they're gone, all this is just gone. Just enjoy that. Enjoy the progress. Enjoy the fact, wow, I'm already there. Wow. I'm almost there. It's straight. Wow. This is great. I'm struggling with this one. This is really... This is a mega wow, for sure. It's affecting my breath a little bit. As far as nervousness, that's not good. If you're keeping full stop in the wow, your breath should just be steady, actually. Don't try to make your breath steady. Don't focus on your breath. Focus on your poise, full stopness. But if you're struggling with your breath, realize that you need to do a better job of full stopping. What I'm doing now is forgiveness, thanking all of this nonsense for being there for so long. At least trying to do that. And there is a strong sense of like disorientation in some way. Not a functional disorientation, but it's like the whole landscape has vanished. All the troubles like have vanished suddenly. It's like, what do I do without these troubles? You know, how do I function without all these troubles? Definitely shocked by this. So the first step I'm doing is just giving it time. No hurry, no hurry, no hurry. Relax in that. Don't struggle with the struggle. Oh, I'm struggling? Great. Enjoy the struggle. As long as you want to struggle. As long as I want to struggle, that's fine. That's great. Let's just struggle for a while then. Let's just feel shocked for a while. See, first, don't struggle with the struggle. Say, okay, great, let's just feel shocked for a while. Wonderful, I deserve it. This is a wonderful prize for all this work. Feel staggered, stunned by this. My problems just vanished. My future problems, all the problems I structured my future around have just vanished. I thought, well, I'm gonna be dealing with these problems who knows how long. So now suddenly, poof, gone. Wow. So right away I say, well, I'm not going to be trying to do anything right now. I'm just going to be sitting quietly. So I don't need to worry about functioning at this moment, at this right now. That's why I say monastic life is so helpful. Monastic culture is so helpful. Where you're allowed and even encouraged to have blocks of time where you're not doing anything except sitting quietly. Very important. Where you don't feel like you have to function, because the whole point of this practice is to evaporate your plans for the future. You don't need them. You don't need the future. Therefore, you don't need plans to plan the future. And this hits you hard as shock. And the way to get over the shock, full stop, is to not have to do anything, just sit quietly. So I'm saying monastic culture is super helpful, super helpful. And I'm just doing that here where I am now. I'm in a situation where I don't have to do an excessive amount of stuff. The pressure's not on me too terribly. So I can feel it's okay to sit here and just like, wow, I don't know what to do. I don't know how to function. I don't know what to do, so I don't know what my functionality is supposed to be at this moment. And if you start thinking you need to function, you start panicking, and that's what affects your breath. That's what affects your breath. So I was momentarily panicking a little bit, thinking, wow, what am I going to do with today? What am I going to do? I don't know. What am I going to do with the future? I don't know. And I said, well, that's okay. Don't need to know. Don't need to do anything right now. That's why I'm saying churches should be open 24 hours a day for people to go when they feel like this like a wow moment is coming up. They can go to church and just sit there and no one will bother them. And they're praying, they're in meta contemplation. No one will say, hey, get back to the world. What's your functionality supposed to be? See, this is very bad. This is the problem with the New World Order, is they're going to regulate everything, including the amount of time you can spend in church, when the churches are open, all this stuff. But they say, we need everything blueprinted. They don't make any allowances for monastic culture at all. They insisted that it doesn't really exist, or if it exists, oh sure it exists, but it's a trillion light years away from here. You know, so in the meantime. We went to church on Thanksgiving to check to see if it was open. It wasn't. You know what was open? Coffee shops. Were open. Entertainment places are open. Bars are open, you know. But the church was closed. I said, oh, that's not good. Closed when we're not here. Nobody's here to supervise. You know. That's a shame. That's a sign of the time, as you see. In monastic culture, there'd always be somebody there. Okay. And so there'd always be a caretaker. So the church is always open. It's always 24 hours a day. It's always open. So there's a place where you can go where the demands of the plans of the world, the blueprint of the world for your future are in abeyance. They can't get you there. So when you're in there, hands off. It's called sanctuary. It's a sanctuary, actually. Actually, supernature we can think of as a sanctuary from cosmic corporate culture. Sanctuary. So super, super, super helpful. You need to feel like there's a place where you can go where the authority of the world, bureaucracy, cosmic corporate culture can't touch you, cannot touch you, where you can feel like, hey, right now, I don't have any plans for the future at all. They just evaporated. I'm in shock. I'm not sure how to function. And you can get used to that. This is what religion is all about. Get you ready to be a citizen of supernature. And this is what's under massive attack in the world right now. Something got in the mail yesterday about an attack on religious leaders and saying, you must donate. These people are trying to interfere with the separation of church and state separation. And then they have a form there and where you're supposed to inform. They say, if you see any violation of church-state separation, fill out this form with the names and times and dates of who violated and when. It's a report. You're supposed to turn in this report, and they say we will process all these reports and send it to the proper authorities to take legal action against them. This is what we received in the mail yesterday. They sent it to the wrong people, didn't they? Well, the Holy Spirit sent it to just say, this is what's going on. This is what's going on. And they're targeting specific religious leaders. And they have 10 religious leaders they're targeting. One of them was Tim LaHaye, I think, the Left Behind books. You know, they're targeting these high-ranking religious leaders, claiming that they're attacking the separation of church and state. What's really happening is that we say, what about this separation of state and church? That's what's under attack, is they're trying to regulate the church and have a blueprint to how it's supposed to be functioning. They have a blueprint for everything. So there's no possibility of just having plans of the future evaporate, poof, a place, a sanctuary. They don't want any sanctuaries here at all for that. And this is their real goal. This is what they're attacking. And they're calling it, what they want is no separation between state and church, is what they want. They want total statism, is what their goal is. It's called statism. This is what's happening. They want total statism. This is the incorporation of cosmic corporate culture is incorporating this planet into total statism. So they want no separation between state and church at all. And church is trying to say, wait a minute, we want a separation between church and state. And they're saying, no, that's a violation of statism. You see, you're trying to, get some separation from the state. You can't have that. This is what they're saying. And it's super aggressive. They're now literally mass mailing these forms to everyone that they can. I think everybody, they send it to us. How in the world would we ever get on such a list? I think they're saying to everyone. And saying, here's a form. Make it easy for you. Fill out the form as a report form, reporting someone as violating separation of what they call church and state, the separation. In other words, you can't bring anything to do with religion or church into what? Into life here, is what they're really saying. It has no place at all. And they're saying anything you do is a violation of separation, of church-state separation. In other words, any teaching you give, oh, for the status, everything is the state. So any talk of the church at all is a violation of separation of church-state, inherently, you see. This is what is happening. This is why I'm telling you. This is what's happening. Everybody is getting these report forms to fill out and send into the bureaucracy. So the bureaucracy then will take legal repressive action against this. What is this? Communist China is what it is. That's where we're heading. Or worse, actually. It's exactly what China did. Is you're supposed to report any violation of lack of compliance with the state bureaucracy, what they wanted. So you cannot have any freedom of thought, of religion, of no plans for now. Everything was central planning, was telling you how to plan your life. Any violation was supposed to be reported. And if you didn't report it, you were in violation. And the children are reporting their parents. They raised they educated the children to report their parents. And this is what's exactly what's being done in the United States right now. We're using the Chinese, communist Chinese model here in the United States now, as a matter of fact. The children are being taught in school to report now if the parents start talking about religion or various other things that they're not supposed to. They're supposed to report the parents to the teachers, actually, as child abuse. Is that they're trying to broaden the term of child abuse to mean certain religious teachings in the home, the family. So the statism is taking over the family and the church, just exactly like in communist China. And it's doing it here in the United States, it's doing it all over the world. What they're telling is you can't be a citizen of supernature. They say, well, sure, you know, maybe a trillion years from now, we'll get there, don't worry. In the meantime, we have this blueprint for you to how to get there. Say, this is our blueprint of how to get there. We got all these plans. But their plan is to make conditioned existence, determinant, delusion, nature, equally attractive to reality, the absolute freedom of reality. So they say, you don't need to get there. Guess what? We got good news. You don't even need to get back home. This is now equally attractive to you. See, so you can stay here. No continuity problem. We solved it all for you. This is their delusion. This is their severe delusion. Imprisonment can never be equally attractive to us as the sheer absolute freedom that we are. Never, 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 never. So they are peddling futility to everyone under the guise of this meticulous blueprint. Say, how we can't fail? Look at this blueprint. We're just going to tweak it and get it better and better. And, you know, no. It's absolute futility is what it is. Said by 2:16, you think I'm being alarmist? Not at all. Not at all. We're literally receiving in the mail, and I'm sure we'll receive more and more and more pressure to report any violation of separation of church and state. And again, the statists believe they have absolute authority over everything here. So any church at all is a violation, and from their definitions, it's a violation. And anything, therefore, any church in the future, religion in the future, will be at their pleasure. Entirely. They say, well, we might allow a little bit of that, just like the Chinese allow some state-sponsored Catholicism or Christianity or something, but they're only allowed at the pleasure of the central planner state, and they plan for them how to use their religious, so quote-unquote, freedom. It's not freedom at all. That's exactly where we're headed now. We're fast-tracked on it. Fast-tracked. So we already have all the snitch culture. We already have a snitch culture. And just like the Chinese and in the cultural revolution, all, you know, they use the pressure of the Red Guards on everyone. Well, social media, Twitter, Facebook, social media is a similar pressure like the Red Guards applied to communist China. That's the kind of pressure we're getting now. It's bullying pressure, super intimidating. It says you will do what the central planners tell you to do, or else we'll send you to the boondocks. You know, you can break rocks. In Samarkand, you know, out there in the Taklamakan Desert. The Western provinces, you know, you're banished to the Western provinces to break rocks, build roads and railroads and stuff. And, you know, you die within a couple years, most of them. Relocated to the Western provinces. That's what they did. As the Russian communists relocated, the Bolsheviks relocated them to Siberia. Road of bones, make, you know, build roads in Siberia. Be productive. Be productive. We can't have you meditating and evaporating the future. It's realizing you don't need it. We need you to be productive. So you seem like you're a good, strong, productive person. You're just not motivated. You just don't have guidance from central planning. So I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to send you to Siberia or the Western province, the Taklamakan Desert, or what is it, Xinjiang or something, province, the old Silk Road area, you know. And you're going to be productive there. We're going to teach you how to be productive. Re-education. Re-educating you to learn how to be productive and plan your future properly like that. And it's good for you, they say. It's good, helpful, re-education. I say, no, thank you, but no thanks. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. But I'm a citizen of SuperNature, so don't need that. Don't need the central planning. So I've never needed anyone to plan my day for me or anything. I can just flow. Go anywhere and just flow and try to just feel a flow of the beauty and just, that's it. I don't need to do anything else. Literally, that's difficult here. It's quite difficult, actually, especially under these circumstances. Yeah, Jesus admits it is difficult. Theoretically, you can do that. It is possible. You can, yes. And as much as possible, we should do that. So, folks, the United States is the new China, is the new communist China. It is the next wave of revolution, the communist revolution. The president of the United States, let's face it, he's a communist. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. And we all know that. It's just that the progressives, being communists too, they love it. They say, well, sure, what's the problem? That's great. We'll finally get this central planning we've been working on for so long. So the next wave revolution of communism is United States of America. So that's where it's taking place. Snitch culture is already in place. Repercussions are already in place. The Red Guard, the bullies are already in place. The internet bullies are already in place. My God, they just crush people mercilessly, don't they? I'm a citizen of SuperNature, so take a hike. You know? I take refuge in SuperNature. I take refuge in the embassy of SuperNature here. Absolutely. I'm a citizen of SuperNature. I'm in this jungle, nightmare jungle here. But I don't lose diplomatic immunity because of that, you see. So just like if you're a citizen of a certain country and you're a diplomat and you go to another foreign country, you have diplomatic immunity. You can take refuge in your embassy if you need to. Absolutely you can. And you do have safe passage out of that country. Absolutely. Same with being a citizen of SuperNature. You have immunity here. You have safe passage out of this realm, actually. We're all citizens of SuperNature. We just, some of us deny it, you know. So we act as a, so we say, no, I don't have any of this immunity. No, I'm vulnerable. I'm subject to disempowerment and all this. So again, anytime you're meditating, getting clarity, always account for the wow. Always account for it. It's hitting very hard again. It's just because this information is tremendous. It changes your plans entirely, doesn't it? Change a plan. That throws us off a bit, doesn't it? Of course it always does. If we make this huge change of plan, boom, throws us off. Absolutely, and then everyone needs to chill out. This is why I say monastic culture is the way. This is what is targeted. How much monastic culture is there in China right now? Well, that's how much monastic culture we're going to have in the United States and globally very soon. Look what they did to Falun Gong, you know. Wow, super repressive, right? They were just trying to breathe a little bit. So the state is saying, wait, the churches are not regulated. We need to regulate them, totally. Any lack of regulation is a violation of separation of state, of church and state, you know. They're trying to impinge upon our authority. That's what they're saying. They're trying to impinge upon our authority, which they insist is total. So if their authority is a total, why even talk about impingement? Let's just talk about total dictatorship, total tyranny, which is what the statists really are, is total tyranny. Thanks, but no thanks. I could say more, but it'd be too much shock, I think. Enough's enough. This is already very intense. Careful not to go into the ramifications of it, which I'm struggling with right now. Because if you don't account for the shock and let it cool down, you'll overthink the situation. You get stuck in your thoughts. So first, feel the freedom. Get used to the freedom. And then once you get used to freedom, you'll think differently. Your options will be different. Then when you're in the shock, still thinking about, okay, I'm in shock. Well, what do I do? Wait till the shock wears off. And then consider, okay, what do I, that's why I say full stop in the wow. Very important. Otherwise, you won't be able to make progress in this really deep ways. He'll overthink the situation. So you say, I don't know. What do I do? I don't know. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know. Just rest and I don't know. I don't know anything. Meaning, I don't have any plans. I don't know anything. Says on a SuperNature, says, I don't know anything. Meaning, I don't need any plans for the future whatsoever. I think someone's coming. So, with that, we will say, very great, and that's it.